Hello everyone, welcome back to the Project Management Processes in the Project Management Body of Knowledge. This is really exciting because we're going through all of the processes, and these processes themselves actually form the basis of, you know, the checklist of things that you'll need to perform as part of managing a project or even being in a project. And maybe you can check that someone is actually going through the proper steps. This is how we do it. This one in particular is perform integrated change control. And you can see all of the processes here. This is where we fit into the greater scheme of things, where we've got perform integrated change control up here in the monitoring and controlling process group. So now we're monitoring the project, we're controlling the project, and we might need to make changes to baselined documents like scope, schedule, or cost, or even quality in some cases. And those changes need to go through the proper procedure and then go back into the project management plan, all the way back here where we developed the project management plan. So what is perform integrated change control? Well, it's the process of reviewing all change requests, approving changes, and managing changes to deliverables, project documents, and the project management plan itself, which was a baselined document, if you recall, and communicating those decisions to the appropriate stakeholders in your project. Why do we do this? Well, the key benefit is that it allows for documented changes within the project to be considered in an integrated manner. Well, so in other words, we're not just making the decision ourselves to make a change to the project scope and then saying, well, here, customer, here's what we've delivered. And then they say, hang on a minute, that wasn't what we wanted. So we need to go through the proper change control processes. So we're addressing project risk. Project risk will arise from changes made without consideration to the overall project objectives or plans. So by going through the proper process, we're having the proper consideration to the overall project objectives or plans and the people involved, the cost that might be involved, or the impact to other things like schedule. Here's an overview of perform integrated change control. First of all, it's conducted from the start to through to completion, and it's the ultimate responsibility of the project manager. Changes can be requested by any stakeholder involved with the project, and it may occur at any time throughout the project lifecycle. Before baselines are established, so before something is locked in place in a certain point in time, like the cost, we all agree on the cost, or we all agree on the schedule, for example. Before that's all agreed, any changes don't have to go through the formal change request or the perform integrated change control process. But once something is baselined or locked at a point in time, change requests have to go through this process. So anything has to be go through the proper change request process. And the project's configuration management plan will note the documents that are baselined. So you'll see that come up sometimes in your PMP exam also. The configuration management plan just tells us which documents need to be baselined, and the change management plan tells us how to go about making those changes and informing the right people. If you're on a large enough project, it might have a change control board or a CCB, and you will see this come up as well in your exam. The customer or sponsor approval may be required for certain change requests after the CCB approval. So in other words, you might raise a change request, it might go through to the change control board, and then it still might need approval by the actual sponsor, the person who's sponsoring this particular project in the first place, unless they are a part of the change control board themselves. So that's something to consider. Approved change requests can require new or revised cost estimates. Of course, if you're making a change to scope, then it might change the cost involved, might change the schedule involved too, or the resources involved, or any risk response alternatives. So a few things could be affected. Inputs, tools, and techniques and outputs for perform integrated change control. We've got the project management plan as an input. Of course, we need to know what we are delivering after all. We've got project documents, various different documents that will be an input into performing integrated change control. Work performance reports, so what have we reported on, how is our project tracking, any existing change requests that have been made, and EEFs and OPAs, so regulations or templates existing. tools and techniques that you'll use as part of this project are expert judgment. We've seen this come up a lot. You will need experts, so in particular areas, and you'll need to gather that information from them. Some change control tools that might involve systems, even your project management information system, if you've got baselines documents kept in that system, for example. Any data analysis that you might need to do, decision making, and of course, meetings to facilitate some of those decisions. The outputs of this particular process are approved change requests. This is our main one. So our input is a change request, and someone's requested a change. It's gone through the proper process, perform integrated change control process, and the output is approved or maybe declined. Maybe it's rejected. And we still need to communicate that to the appropriate people as well. We've got project management plan updates and of course project documents updates too. There are many different processes that you'll see have an input into perform integrated change control because almost every process will require a change at some point. So you've got procurements, risks, validate the scope, managing the team and resources. All of those things can require change, and that's why they'll have an input into perform integrated change control. And of course, perform integrated change control itself will have an input into directing and managing the project work because it might change what we're delivering. Controlling quality because it might change the deliverables, so what we're actually testing. And controlling procurements because third parties or someone that we've agreed to do the work for us, that might change the work that they're doing too. Let's look at the inputs in a little bit more detail. The project management plan, we might have as an input the change management plan. So how are we actually managing those change requests? The configuration management plan as well. What documents or items have been baselined? Is it the project management plan? Is it the scope statement, for example? Write them down and they'll be noted in your configuration management plan. The scope baseline, schedule baseline, and cost baseline, all of those things are locked in a certain point in time. And if they need changes, we need to know about those and they'll be an input into this process. Of course, we need to know the basis of what we've estimated, the requirements traceability matrix. So what did the customer require initially versus what are we delivering? This is in a nice matrix usually, and it matches up. You'll see a little bit more of this under scope, but usually it will match up. We show how it matches up. And if that changes, then we need to know about it. Of course, we might have the risk report as well, what risks might change or be impacted by making a change to this particular project. Work performance reports, so all of that information it might include resource availability, schedule and cost data, earned value, is that going to change, or burn down charts, so is it going to impact the schedule of our project? And that's something that we need to consider when we're making a change. Now, the big input into perform integrated change control are the change requests themselves. So they will have an impact on all of those project baselines, and they should normally include information about the cost of implementing the change, the modifications in scheduled dates that might happen, any resource requirements that might happen as a result of the change, and of course, risks that have been considered as a part of this change. Now, it does need to be approved by the change control board if you have one. Each project is different. Sometimes you will, sometimes you won't, but it definitely needs to be approved by the customer or sponsor, unless they're a part of the CCB itself. So only approved changes should be incorporated back into your project management plan or revised baselined document. Of course, with many of these things, we've got enterprise environmental factors and organizational process assets. So any regulations or regulatory standards, contracting or purchasing constraints, organizational governance frameworks that are existing in the organization that you're working in. So what standards do you have to work to currently for this particular thing? And are there existing change control procedures or templates that you have to use that can actually help you if there's an existing template? Now you just fill it in as part of what the organization wants and it's a lot easier. There might be a configuration management knowledge base or procedures for issuing and approving change authorizations already in place. For example, if you've got a project management office, they might have certain procedures that you have to abide by. And again, That will usually make it a little bit easier because you know the process to go through. You will need expert judgment of the experts in the particular areas that you're looking into for legal or procurement, legislation or regulations, configuration management for those particular items, scope, schedule, cost, the experts in those particular areas or the owners of those particular things in the project. Any risks as well, you might need experts from where the project is being delivered into because they really understand the process and they really understand the product and they can see risks that might happen as part of this being delivered. Now, of course, you might have alternatives and cost-benefit analysis that need to be done as part of your tools and techniques. You'll come across change control tools. So in order to facilitate configuration and change management, manual or automated tools may be used. You might want to identify the configuration item. So is it the scope statement, for example? Record and report the configuration item status. So where is it currently up to? What is the status? Is it partway complete, for example? And then perform configuration item verification and audit. So once the change has been made, what is the new status of that item? If it needs to be audited and put back into the project management plan, then that's all we can do. And tools are also used to manage the change requests and the resulting decisions, where we identify the changes, document them, decide on those changes, and then ultimately track those changes. And some of that information you'll see will go into any of the systems that you use as part of your project management information system. Maybe it's a repository here, or maybe it's a Kanban board of issues or items tracked, and how they're going along, that sort of thing. Many different options that you'll have. Now, to facilitate all of this, you will need decision-making techniques such as voting, autocratic decision-making, and multi-criteria decision analysis, which we have looked at before. Voting, you'll have things like unanimity, where 100% of people agree, majority, where you've got more than 50%, and plurality, where you've just got the largest block of people agreeing. And so that's the different outcomes that you might have as part of voting. Multi-criteria decision analysis is usually a matrix of different options, and does this one meet this option? Does that one meet that option? And that will help you decide based on, you know, the benefits that you'll get out of that particular outcome. And of course, meetings themselves. There will always be meetings as part of your project, and sometimes it's the fastest way to get that decision that you need. So change control meetings are held with the change control board. And again, if it's not the change control board in your project, it might be the project sponsor, or it might be whoever else is actually managing those changes, depending on what you've agreed on at the beginning when you're initiating your project. Most of those changes will have some sort of impact on time, cost, resources, or risks. And so assessing the impact of those changes is an essential part of this particular meeting. Alternatives to the requested changes may also be discussed and proposed. And finally, the decision is communicated to the request owner. So who's requested that change, or the group who has requested that change. We're communicating whatever that outcome is back to those people just so that they know. Now let's look at the outputs of Perform Integrated Change Control. Of course, we want approved change requests. So we had our change request come in, it's gone through the process, and now this is the approved change request that comes out of this process. The change requests are processed according to the change management plan by the project manager or the change control board or an assigned team member, if that's appropriate, depending on what you've agreed. Approved change requests will be implemented through the direct and manage project work process. So now we're going to actually direct and manage that particular change, make sure it gets delivered. Deferred or rejected change requests are communicated back to the personal group requesting that change. So they still need to know even if the change has been rejected. But the disposition of all change requests are recorded in the change log. So maybe there's a log of changes, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 changes have been requested, 5 have been approved, 5 have been rejected. But they still need to be put somewhere so that we understand what changes have been requested over the life of our project. Now, lastly, of course, any part of the project management plan can be updated if we're making changes, that makes sense, and project documents as well. Any basically the change log is probably the biggest one that will be updated. As we saw, we'll just need to log any of those changes, but other items can be changed as well as part of your project and the changes that go through. And that's perform integrated change control as part of the project management body of knowledge.